For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life.
O Timothy, guard what has been entrusted to you, avoiding worldly and empty chatter and the opposing arguments of what is falsely called knowledge or gnosis, which some have professed and thus gone astray from the faith. Grace be with you. And Paul signs off on that book. Before we have a word of prayer, let me remind you that for those who are with us by internet, that if you want to study the entirety of the of 1 Timothy, then you can go to our website, doctrinalstudies.com, and that will be up there for you. You can go through the entire book. As I mentioned, the greater context of our lesson today begins in verse 12. And in the greater context, Paul has laid out his final instructions to Timothy with four imperatives. Four imperatives. Now, we have looked at these imperatives and what were each imperative, a command, Greek imperative is a command, and with each of these is a doctrine that's important. For example, in verse 12, the first part of verse 12, he says, fight, that's an imperative. See that on your paper? Fight is an imperative. It's a present middle imperative. And what are we fighting? We're fighting the good fight of faith. So he's talking about fighting for faith of the new covenant. Then in verses 12 through 16, in verse 12b, he tells you, take hold. Notice that's an imperative. It's an aorist middle imperative. These are all second person singulars because he's speaking to Timothy. And so take hold of, and take hold of what? See, eternal life. And there's a doctrine. We're to fight for faith. We are to take hold of eternal life. These are the things he's telling Timothy. I'm telling you, there are four doctrines here that are very important for you to teach the church. The third imperative is the word instruct or charge. And it's a present active imperative, second person singular. We talked about this last week. God's guaranteed investments, the foundation of your future, laying up treasures in heaven. And we talked about that last week. He said this is very important. Your stay on earth is short compared to your stay in heaven as a believer. You need to lay up treasures in heaven, not just on earth. It's okay to build your investment portfolio for the future of your time on earth, but don't do it at the expense of the eternal investments, your treasure in heaven. Today, we're looking at the word guard. Plulasso is our word today. It's an aorist active imperative. It's a second person singular. It is translated the King James. It's probably the word guard. Susanna, is the word guard? It's probably guard. Guard. It's the same almost in all translations. The New American Standard that I read from is the word guard. But what is interesting about this word is it has a strong military background. Blue lasso is a word that means to guard as a sentry on duty, and it means to guard something with your life, to guard it with your life. Plulasso means not just to guard it. It doesn't mean get a good guard dog. It doesn't mean give this responsibility to somebody else and pay him to do it. This means that you are to do this, and you're to do this at even your life's risk. That's pretty strong, isn't it? Now, if you spent any time in the military, they taught you guard duty, and they taught you this principle. And if they caught you not living up to that principle, you were severely disciplined. You could lose ranks and all kinds of things. And I'm talking about in civilian time, and I'm not talking about wartime. So it's an enormously strong word. And notice it's an aorist tense. It's aorist imperative. It's a very strong hut to command. It's a very strong command, the aorist. And the aorist tense means when you hear this importance, the importance of this. Now, it depends. And here's something else about it. I need to have prayer because I can feel my engine starting to rev. Let me pause for a moment and have a word of prayer with you because I need now to get in my lesson. Okay? So remember, once again, you're going to have your thinking cap on of 2 Peter 3:16. He wants to teach you something very important. Listen, this could put your life at risk. This lesson here can put your life at risk. Listen, I want you to write this down as a sidebar for you to look at. Here's what it means to guard what I'm going to talk about today. 2 Corinthians 11th chapter. Paul talks about his missionary trips and what it involved. Let me tell you what. You go on a mission trip, it may go smooth, or it may go like 2 Corinthians 11. You need to get this message if you want to be evangelical. You need to get this message today because you're to guard the deposit. This word entrusted means something that has been deposited to you because God thinks you're worthy of trust with it. And it's a big deal. It is a big deal. And listen, when you take this serious and you carry the gospel out there, this is what he's talking about. You take the message and mechanics of a grace gospel salvation, and you've got to guard it. It could be guarding it with your life, because they drug them out of the city, they stoned them, they beat them, they humiliated them, they took their property from them. We have had it so good in America because of God's magnificent grace, and because the Church of Jesus Christ has had a great light through their community to the world. And when that light goes off in America, you're going to find when the church, and listen, there's a dim light in the church today. You look at this church and see right here, we teach the Word of God. We pound it out. You can see how many vacancies we have in a small church. This is an enormous message. This is the fourth and final doctrine that he says is so vitally important to the church to have a great ministry in the world. You've got to understand faith. You've got to understand eternal life. You've got to understand where your true treasures are, and you've got to understand that you've got to guard what's been entrusted to you, what's been entrusted to every believer. You must guard it with your life. Listen, there are places in the world today, there are places in the world where this is actually going on, where they walk into the house and take the children out and say, do you believe that Jesus died for your sins, was buried and raised from the dead, and you believe you can be saved by grace, and you believe you can go to heaven, and you say yes, boom, they shoot your children. You do know that. Or cut their head off. You do know we live in that kind of a world, don't you? And do you know that world is just at one airfare away from us? There's a lot of reasons that you need to hear this message today. So let's have a word of prayer. Let me have a word of prayer with you. Be sure you're filled with the Holy Spirit. Make confession of sin if necessary, according to 1 John 1:9, mental attitude, sins, sins of the tongue, overt sins. I need to have this moment of prayer with you. Father, we're thankful for this time together. We're thankful for 1 John 1:9 that says, if I confess my sin, you are faithful and just to forgive me and cleanse me. And that allows me to be restored to the sanctificational work of the Holy Spirit in the teaching hour. It is to teach me the truth of the Word of God to set me free from the world's lies. I pray for that today, Father, as we look at this great lesson on guard the deposit. Guard it with your life. That's the value of your life on earth. That's why Christ offers you heaven. This life is not all there is. It's not all there is. Pray, Father, you teach us, Father, what it means to guard the deposit in Jesus' name. Amen. Guard the deposit. I want to talk about four things about guarding the deposit of grace salvation. In today's lesson, Paul commanded Timothy to guard. He used a military word. I explained that. This is a strong military word. When he puts an aorist imperative, that's a hut-to-strong imperative. You guard and you guard it with your life. You know, one of the interesting things about sentry duty was that when I was awake, everybody else was asleep. You know how important that is to a combat soldier? Remember, my Uncle Glenn came home from the Second World War. He fought on the islands. He had scars all over his body from bayonets, going out, rooting out Japanese off in the islands. I mean, he's stabbed all over himself. He hardly ever took his shirt off. I mean, he hardly ever saw him without a long sleeve shirt on. And he said, the greatest part of a fighting unit, you fight all day and you fight all night. You can hardly drag yourself one foot above the other. Just intense fighting all day, all night. You're dead on your feet, and what you need is some R&R. I just need 5 minutes. If I could just shut my eyes, 5 minutes. And he said, the wonderful thing about the American combat is if you can get back to your base, the company commander knows this, and he has a reserve. Always there's a couple guys in reserve. And when you fall in to your safe zone, which is not really safe, you understand that, because you're on the front lines. It is safe because they put sentry guys out there that understand why you need that sleep, because they were on the last tour. And because they're your comrades, because they've been where you are, they have felt your pain and need for rest. They guard you all night long, and you sleep like a baby because you know they are guarding you with their life. That's what I'm talking about. This is what I'm talking about. We're so soft in America. I'm appreciative of that. I complain about the dumbest things compared to the rest of the men of God out there cranking it out, whose life are not at risk. Most things people shoot at me is words. I get some hate mail every once in a while. People write me and tell me why they left the church and why I'm a slug. Listen, that's nothing to compare to what I just talked about. This lesson today is for us in America as well as anywhere it could ever be. You've got to be prepared to guard, if need be, with your life, the grace gospel of salvation, both the message and the mechanics. And so this is what Paul is now, in his final words of instructions, this is what he tells Timothy. Guard what has been entrusted. You see that in your Bible? That's not what it says. See, this appears in the English as that's a verbal form, doesn't it? Does that look like a verbal form? What has been entrusted? It looks like a verbal form to me. There's no verb there. There's no verb there. There's no verb there. That's a direct object of the word guard without verb. Actually, what this says is guard the deposit. The verb is the word guard. It doesn't, guard is not a noun. It's a verb. It's a strong verb. The word guard, it's not guard what has been entrusted. It is guard with your life the deposit, what's been entrusted. See, the deposit, the entrustment. Oh, I want you to get this because this is what God has entrusted you with. He has, this word is committed, deposit, or entrusted. But it's a direct object. It's an accusative. It's in the accusative case. Therefore, the emphasis is guard the deposit. Guard the deposit. This is what it says. There's, what am I? I want you to guard with your life. What? The deposit. It's very strong. These two things are linked in this command. And the Greeks have done it in the most magnificent way. What has been committed, the deposit. What has been, listen to me, this is what this means. What has been deposited into your trust? What has been deposited into your trust? And this is true. Teach everybody, because this is true with every church age believer. And what would that be? That would be that way for all of us. It is the gospel of grace salvation. It is the message and the mechanics that we are to guard with our life. And listen, when you study the book of Acts, when these guys got out on the road and started doing this stuff, there's what you see, what he talks about. The book of Acts. I mean, they put them in jail. They did everything in the world. When they got out, they went and preached the same gospel. Why? Because they are to guard the deposit. They didn't change their message. They put them in jail. They threatened them. They confiscated their stuff. They preached it in the prison. They preached it in the court system. And they preached it when they left. So they finally chopped their head off. And the person who picked up the head and the body and buried it went out and preached the gospel. What had been deposited to him? And that's why we sit here today, because there were those of our ancestry in Christ who always guarded the grace gospel of Jesus Christ. That's why we sit here today. And if we don't, there'll be, this place will be empty. Because it is a gospel that changed people's life. Changed mine. If it didn't change yours, something wrong. It may not change the way mine's been changed, but it's been changed. You were in darkness, now you're in light. You were in death, now you're in life. I mean, do you not know the change? So you're a good person. Listen, you weren't the best. You weren't godly. You were good, but not godly. There's a difference. It's a matter of O's. Listen, this is such a powerful idea. The translators made entrusted into a verbal form what is actually a direct object. Guard what? Guard what? And he says the deposit. That deposit is true. This deposit that we're to guard is the deposit of grace salvation in every believer. It is the gospel. It is the message of mechanics. So we're going to go over it again, because this is what you got to guard. I got to make sure this is drill instruction. This is combat ready training here. And see whether or not you're ready for sentry duty. Here's what you got to guard. You got to guard 1 Corinthians 15:3 and 4. This is the message that Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. Christ came into the world to save us from sin. Just as the scripture says, Old Testament. He was buried and raised from the dead the third day, according to the scriptures, Old Testament scriptures. In other words, he fulfilled shadow Christology. He fulfilled the prophetic gospel into historical gospel. He fulfilled it. That's the message. You know, everybody talks about a full gospel. I'll tell you what a full gospel is. That Jesus Christ died for your sins, was buried, and raised from the dead the third day. That's a full gospel. And listen, he's got to be raised from the dead. Otherwise, you got three people died for crime. Who died for sin? Which one of them died for sin is the issue. Who died for my crime? Listen, the guy hanging in the middle died for the two guys on each side of him who had committed crime. And one of those guys got saved. Because he understood it. You got to understand the mechanics. The second point of a mechanic is, what do I have to do to be saved? Romans 1:16. The gospel, which we just explained, 1 Corinthians 15:3 and 4. The gospel is the power of God to save everyone who believes. And it doesn't matter who that person is. Doesn't matter if it's Jew or Gentile. Doesn't matter if it's male or female. Doesn't matter if rich or poor. Doesn't matter if it's slave or free. Right? Galatians, the third chapter. Doesn't matter. Everybody comes the same way. You come by faith. Or you don't come at all. You come by faith. You don't come by works. You come by faith. The gospel is the power of God that saves the person who believes the gospel. When you believe the gospel, God saves you. God saves you. God saves you through the gospel. The gospel is a person. It's not a thing. The gospel is a person. It's about a person. The gospel is about a person. They're qualified to die on our behalf. Ephesians 2, 8, and 9 gives us mechanics. Here's the second line of mechanics that lead off from believe. The word belief is pistuo. That's a verbal form of pistis, the word faith. One's a verb and one's a noun. Same word, one's a verb and one's a noun. One is telling you what you have to believe. The other tells you what you got when you believed. Faith. When you believe, you got faith. When you don't believe, you don't have faith. You have doubt. Come on now. So Ephesians 2, 8, 9 is a great passage. It says, for by grace, that is God's gospel doing salvation, for by grace are you saved through faith. When you believe, now it's become faith. The verbal action has now become the noun structure of what I believe. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourself. Nada. And not of yourself. It is a gift of God. Not of works. Lest any man boast. Mechanics. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes. You see, you're saved by grace through faith and not of yourself. It is a gift of God. Not of works.
of works.
See, that's what Paul pounded in Galatians 2:16. That's not on your paper. It should be. And then the great message that Jesus gave in John 10:28-30. When he talks about the security of your salvation. I mean, who saved me? God. Was it 100% God? Absolutely. Oh, no, no. Was it 95% God and, you know, 5% Ron? No. Was it 99% God and 1% Ron? No. It was 100% God and 0 Ron. That's why it's a gift, not of works. If there's any work, then it's what's due. That's what Paul talks about in Romans 4. If there's any work involved in it, then you're getting your due. You're getting your wages. That's not salvation. That's not what you're to guard. What I'm telling you is what you must guard. It is the grace principle of salvation of the new covenant. John, the 10th chapter, listen to this. It's well worth your look. Put your eyes on it. John 10. Now, there are a lot of passages. This just happens to be mine. Since I'm teaching, I get to call it. This is mine. I'm going to tell you, I can't tell you how many times this passage saved my bacon with people who came and lied to me. And today I guard this message. Listen to what it says. In verse 28, I give eternal life to them that my sheep hear my voice. I know them, they follow me. I give eternal life to them. They shall never perish. See, John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believe in him should not what? Should not perish, but have everlasting life. You see, perishing is the opposite of eternal life. Perishing is the opposite. Everybody's born perishing. It's one of the 13 judicial charges of Adamic sin. You're perishing. You're dying. You're in a state of death. Spiritually. And when you believe the gospel of Jesus Christ, the perishing is removed, the eternal life is given in its place. Boom, boom. And this is what he says. I give eternal life to them. I give it to you. I give it to you. I give eternal life to them. They shall never perish. No man shall snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. And no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hands. And then I hear people say, well, you're able to snatch yourself out of your own hands. How can you even get yourself in your own hands? You can't even palm a basketball. Good grief. Listen, no one is no one. Let the scriptures tell you the truth. Don't let people lie to you. My Father who has given them to me, why? Because God saves. God saves. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. You see, the Father and I are one. If you're in my hands, I'm in the hands of God. You're pretty secure. Would you not agree with that? And no one, I mean no one, especially you, might I add. Quit that foolishness. Quit letting the devil lie to you. Let the scriptures, Roman, let that John 8:32. You shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Quit putting yourself into bondages that are unnecessary. Okay. Guard the deposit. That's the deposit, people. Now, you can't guard it if you don't believe it. It's been entrusted to you. This is what... Listen, boy, I tell you, if you got caught sleeping on guard duty in basic training... And we I was on sentry duty all the way until I went to Womack Army Hospital and worked. Then I was in, quote, I worked in, quote, the safety zone. But prior to that, you call sentry duty, you better not go to sleep. I don't care. Peacetime meant nothing to these people. And they did all kinds of things to trick you. They played all kinds of enemy warfare on you on sentry duty, which was really good because that's the way life really is in the gospel. Now, the deposit. What the deposit is for me is the 50 things. What is that deposit? It is that great gospel. What is that great gospel deposited? That grace gospel deposit. It is the 50 things received in the package of grace salvation. When it says that God, Romans 1, that the gospel is the power of God unto salvation, what does that mean? Well, for me, that gospel of grace salvation, that great deposit, is the 50 things I receive in salvation I can never lose in time and eternity. I mean, that was so... When I heard this, my pastor teacher taught there were 37. And he was on the front side of it. I mean, he was just building a man. And he was at 37 to show you that salvation is so God and not man. It is so, the package of salvation is so big. So as I came along, I kept extending that thing. I quit at 50. I was up into 67 and 70. And I went, I'm going to cap it at 50. I think 50 is enough just to overwhelm you. It should be. These are not the only, but here are 50 things you can never lose in time and eternity. Somebody come along and say, well, I think you could do this. And say, well, I still got 49. Now, they're not going to work your way through 49 things. They ain't got enough energy. They only got one lie. They're going to run it until they find somebody. They ain't got enough. So, listen to me. The moment a person believes the gospel of Jesus Christ, he gets saved. This is what it means to be saved to me. You get these 50 things. Listen, 13 judicial charges are removed from your life in time and eternity. 13 judicial charges. From Adam's sin. These you get because you're a human being. You're born under 13 judicial charges. You're alienated from God. You're spiritually blind. You're under the curse of the law. You're condemned. You're at enmity with God. You're a natural man, not a spiritual person. As long as you're not saved, you're always natural, no matter how religious you get. You're perishing. You're a sinner. You're a sinner by status, not by conduct, but by position in Adam. In Adam, you're dead. You're in darkness. In Adam, these are all in Adam. These are the results of being in Adam. And listen, you're either in 1 Corinthians 15:22. You're either in Adam or in Christ. You're either in the first Adam or in the last Adam. 1 Corinthians 15:45. You're in one of them. And if you're in Adam, and everybody is until you are saved by the gospel of Jesus Christ, then you have these 13 judicial charges positionally in you. That's spiritually. And Christ, when he died on the cross, removed those. When you believe, those are removed from your life in time and eternity. You're ungodly, you're unrighteous, and you're under the wrath of God. These are 13 judicial charges that the Bible... And listen, you know that little booklet, 50 Things? If you don't, go to our website, you can pull these 50 things down and study them. They're in four categories. 13 judicial charges of Adam. We call that the barrier. The spiritual barrier between man and God are the 13 judicial charges of Adamic sin. That's the barrier. Religion can't remove it. Good works can't remove it. Singing Do Lord Till You Faint can't do it. You got to believe the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the moment you believe the gospel of Jesus Christ, these 13 are removed from your life because you're no longer in Adam, you're now in Christ. If you're in Christ, then you're no longer in Adam. If you're no longer in Adam, these 13 are gone. Hoo-ah. I don't know about you, but I'm starting to get happy feet. Not only that, but you have, listen to me, you have 9 communion factors of the redemptive blood of Christ that is working on your behalf. Listen, here's what I mean by that. The blood of Christ is always working on your behalf. The blood of Christ is always working on your behalf. The moment you get saved, the blood of Christ always works on behalf of the believer. In this way, you are reconciled to God. You are always, because of the blood of Christ, from that cross, you are always reconciled to God. Positionally, you're always there. Never be a day in time and journey when you're not into reconciliation of God. In fact, the great message of 2 Corinthians 5, 17 through 21 is to preach, take the message of reconciliation to the world. You know what that is? When you get saved, you're reconciled to God in time and eternity. That's the great news. That's the message of reconciliation. No longer under 13 judicial charges. You are now in relationship eternally with God. Reconciled to God. Redeemed. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Do you know, not just one day, but every day of your life in time and eternity, you're redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. You're the redeemed. You are the redeemed. You are the redeemed. You are the redeemed. And the redeemed of God, when they commit sin, confess it because the blood of Christ works on their behalf to restore them to fellowship because their relationship is never moved because God is faithful. Every person is under propitiation. No longer, listen, the wrath of God has been appeased forever. You will never under the wrath of God ever again. God may discipline you, but never under wrath, always under love. Oh, come on now. God may discipline you, Hebrews 12, chapter 5 through 11, but it's never his wrath, it's always his love that's working. You ought to be starting to get a little, at least one foot ought to be tapping. You are justified. God always sees you justified. There's never a time after you believe the gospel of Christ when God does not see you justified. His eyes looks upon you with justice. Do you know how important that is? Because listen, one day you're going to meet the judge. And the judge is going to look at you and say, justified by the blood of Christ. Justified. Yes, Father, that's one of mine. Hoo-ah. That's probably what he'll say. Hoo-ah. Forgiven. All of our sins forgiven. Do you know what a deal that is? I bet if you've lived long enough, there's people in your life that has not forgiven you.
For God,
if you live long enough,
world,
you're going to have somebody
that
doesn't forgive you for something.
That he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him,
I have people that wouldn't forgive me because I was a Yankee. Think about that.
Have everlasting life.
I didn't even know what that means. I don't know what that means. My people came from Holland. I don't know what that means. I have no idea what that means. My grandfather was a settler. I don't know what that means. Forgiven. Always forgiven. No matter what, forgiven. Because of the blood of Christ, we're always forgiven. God only, that's the only way God can see us. We have the cleansing work of Christ working in our life through 1 John 1:9. You know that word, 1 John 1:9? If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to what? Forgive us and what? Cleanse us. Whew. Whew. You know what that does? It restores us to sanctificational work, the work of the Holy Spirit. How wonderful that is. I don't have to go back and get saved again. Larry Tidwell used to sing a song, Walk the Aisle 26,000 times or something, trying to get this kind of security we're talking about today. At peace with God. The blood of Christ always keeps us at peace with God. The blood of Christ, we're at peace with God. Not only that, but we have the peace of God in us through the ministry of the Holy Spirit and the Word of God. Listen, when the peace of God is able to be extended to other people when only war is expected, that's a marvelous thing, isn't it? It's a marvelous thing. Victory in the angelic conflict. How good is that? Victory in the angelic conflict. I got that. I still war, but I got the victory. See, my victory has been established. 1 John 5:4, my fight in the victory of the angelic conflict is to show my faith. Faith is the victory that overcomes the world. And of course, I'm under the new covenant. The blood of Christ has put me under the new covenant. I do it every Eucharist day. Every Eucharist day. 20 status privileges of identity with Christ. We listen to the world tell us who we are. We don't listen to the Bible. I spend so much time counseling Christians who come in and they're all beat up because the world's told them they're a slug. No kidding. No kidding. And then you begin to believe it. I'm no good. I'm not this. I'm not that. I don't know that. Why do you listen to that foolishness? Why do you listen to that? You're a child of God. Listen, do you know the 20 status privileges of who you are in Christ? And every time somebody tells you that you're you never was a good mama. Well, you never was a good daddy. Well, you never was this. You never was that. Yeah. Do you know who you are in Christ? Because that's who you really are. You're a new creation in Christ. You're a new creation in Christ. Believe that and behave that. Listen. You're a brother in Christ. You're a son of God. You're a son of light. You're a child of promise. You're a beloved. You're a chosen. You're a righteous one. You're a possessor of eternal life. You're a firstborn of God. You're a joint heir with an inheritance in Christ. You are a heavenly citizen. You are sanctified. You are a bond slave of Christ. You have been called. You are a living stone in the house of God. You're an ambassador. You are a priest for God. But letting the world tell you lies, tell you you're ugly and not beautiful, you're too tall and not too, and you're too short, you're too fat and you're too thin, you're too bald, you've got too much hair. Stop letting them tell you who you are, because that's not who you are. But listen, you listen to that foolishness because you don't listen to God. God will tell you who you are. You're a new creature in Christ. You're a new creature in Christ. You're a new creature in Christ. But who is that? I just gave you. Get that pamphlet. Go to the website. Pull it down. Study these things. That's who you are. Don't let people tell you you're a bad mama, you're a bad this, you're a bad that. And then you buy into it, you walk around and you beat yourself up all the time. Quit that. That's worldliness. Stop it. This is what I think Paul is saying to Timothy when he says, guard what has been entrusted to you. Guard it. I think he means guard it on the front side of the gospel of grace salvation and guard it on the second half of who your identity is in Christ. You know, the one person that should believe you have the 50 things is you. Now you can explain it to others because they really need to hear it. That is the package of the good news. Not just that you got saved, but you got saved to be a different person. And you are a new creation in Christ. We've been talking about guarding the deposit out of 1 Timothy 6:20, 20 and 21. I want to show you something at point number three, something very important. I want to show you two scriptures that are just dynamite. Now, we've looked at 1 Timothy 6:20. I'm going to remind you what it says, then we're going to go to 2 Timothy 1:12, which is I wrote on your paper. Here is 1 Timothy 6:20. I want you to get this now. O Timothy, guard what has been entrusted to you. The church age believer, every church age believer is commanded to guard what God has deposited in them, has deposited or entrusted to them. They're to guard it. Now look at 2 Timothy 1:12. For this reason, I also suffer these things, talking about him guarding what has been deposited to him. For this reason, I suffer these things, but I am not ashamed. Here's a line from a great hymn, isn't it? For I know whom I have believed and am persuaded, remember, or convinced. Watch this, that he is able to guard what I've entrusted to him. Do you see the difference? There's a sharp difference here. In 1 Timothy 6:20, it's what God, every church member, is what God has deposited in us. And what God is able to guard, God is able to guard what we've entrusted to him is our faith. Do you see that? What he's given us is the gospel of grace salvation. That's what he's deposited to us. And the great message is what we deposit with him is faith, and he guards that. Isn't that amazing? We guard the gospel. He guards the faith of the gospel. Boy, there's security, isn't it? Look at that security idea. Paul's making two wonderful doctrinal points that is often overlooked about this. We're to guard what God has deposited in us, that is the gospel of grace salvation, and God guards what we deposit with him, same word, our faith. For by grace are you saved through faith, and not of yourself, as a gift of God. And so God guard, and we call that saving grace. You know, and when we look at the six divisions of grace, saving grace is how it begins. Surpassing grace is how it ends. But saving grace, saving faith is what he guards. That wonderful, that moment you believe, he guards that faith. God guards it the same way we guard his gospel. That's a marvelous idea. And so Paul makes that in 1 Timothy and 2 Timothy, he makes that idea come alive. The fourth thing that I want to mention today is that in 2 Timothy 1:14, Paul commands, and I wrote it on your paper, Paul commanded Timothy to guard the treasure which had been entrusted to him. Listen, and here's how you guard it. You guard it by the power of the indwelling Holy Spirit. Because that gospel is going to take you to places and people and circumstances of life that's so far out of your control, it's unbelievable. You can read about it in 2 Corinthians 11 chapter when Paul talks about his experience of carrying the gospel on mission trips. Listen to how Paul says it to Timothy in 2 Timothy 1:14 when people go like, Paul, I don't know that I have enough strength. I don't know if I, Paul, I don't know that I could do that. And Paul says, you don't do it in the flesh. You don't guard the gospel under all circumstances, under all adversities. You don't guard it in the flesh. You guard it in the power of the Holy Spirit. That's how the message gets correct. That's how the mechanics gets correct. That's how you're able to stabilize yourself in the midst of great conflict over the gospel. You do it through the ministry of the indwelling Holy Spirit. He writes guard, which is our word plulasso, aorist, active, imperative, second person singular, a command, a hutu command. Guard through the Holy Spirit who dwells in us the treasure which has been deposited, committed, entrusted to us. See that? We don't do this in the flesh. This way too big a deal. So God has empowered us in the new covenant, in the church age. He's empowered each of us by the indwelling Holy Spirit. And by walking in the power of the Holy Spirit, we're able to, no matter what the circumstances, complete the mission. That's a marvelous idea, and I'll tell you, you'll need every bit of it. The indwelling of the Holy Spirit is one of eight works of the Holy Spirit at salvation, part of the package of 50 things. 1 Corinthians 6:19-20 says your body, one of the new things, you know, 2 Corinthians 5:17, we're new creatures in Christ. One of the changes that come is your body is changed into the temple of God. At the point of salvation, the Holy Spirit takes up residence in your body, and your body becomes the temple of God, the naos, the place where God dwells. I want you to turn to 2 Corinthians a moment about what he talks about that. Paul talks about this idea of God indwelling through the Holy Spirit in 2 Corinthians 6. I listed this in verse 16 on your paper. When he's in this discussion that began in verse 14 about partnerships and fellowships and harmonies and all that, now he's into an agreement. On what agreement has the temple of God with idols? None. For we are the temple of the living God, just as God has said. Now he quotes from the Old Testament. I will, watch this now, watch the I wills. I will dwell in them. I will walk among them. Look, how's he going to do that, Holy Spirit? What makes my body the temple? The indwelling of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the third member of the God who not only dwells in us, but listen, is able to walk among us because he indwells one of the among us. For example, you go home, you may be in the house of believers and unbelievers. You may live in the house of horror, I don't know. But I can tell you this, God goes into that, he lives in you, and he walks among you. Do you understand that? When you go to work, when you go to the hospital, wherever you go, He, because of the indwelling third member of God, he walks among them. He walks among the people. God, you're missing it, but I can't do anything about it. I mean, he's just going to have to point it out to you. He walks among you. Because he lives in somebody, he walks among us. He walks among us. And I will be their God. I will be their God, and they will be my people. Therefore, and then he goes on to talk about more things. I just want to show you the dynamics of that indwelling power of the Holy Spirit. I just want to show you that. In Romans 8, chapter verse 9, he says, if you don't have the Holy Spirit, you're not saved. If you don't have the Holy Spirit, you're not saved. And if you are saved, you have the Holy Spirit. That's Romans 8 chapter. Because at the moment of salvation, God does eight works of the Holy Spirit in your life, and one of them is indwell your body. And the reason he does that is so that he can walk among the people and have a witness among the people, to have a witness among the people. In John 14:16, people often ask me, well, John, Ron, can you lose the Holy Spirit? Will he leave you if you get out in the Tules? Will he leave you? I don't know where the Tules is, do you? I don't want to find out. Listen to what Jesus said. This is the upper room discourse before he goes back to the Father. And he's talking about going back to the Father. And he says, when I get there, I will ask the Father. I'm going home. I'm going home. This has been a long, dreary time for me, and I want to go home. I will ask the Father, and he will give you another comforter like him. Not the second member of the Godhead, the third member. That he may be with you forever. You know, forever is forever. And you know what? It ain't dependent on you. It's not dependent on you. The moment you believe the gospel of Jesus Christ, he indwelt you. And he's there by God's command forever. What I'd like to you to understand is he wants to make the best of his trip. But he's stuck with you. Think about that. He's stuck with you. And that it ought to be fun time for him. He ought to really enjoy the trip with you. I mean, you can have fun or not have fun. I suggest have fun. We can make this a good trip or we can make it a bad trip, but it is a trip. Okay? See, I do think God has a sense of humor, don't you? I know the Holy Spirit sometimes thinks he doesn't, but probably. You know what I love about this? You know why he'll never leave me? Not only that, but he wants to have a good trip. Hebrews 13:5. That's an interesting statement. When he says, I will. I mean, he says something none of us could say all the time to everybody. I will never leave you nor forsake you. I was talking to a guy the other day. He said, Ron, I got blindsided. I said, how's that? I know what that means, but I'm always curious about it. How do you get blindsided? Well, somebody just comes up and pops you and you didn't know he was going to do it. Yeah. I said, what happened? How did you, what, you want to talk about it? Apparently he did. He wouldn't have told me that. He said, I came home and my wife was loading up her car with her things. I said, what's going on? And she says, I'm leaving. Well, he's thinking, a trip. Has work or what? You. I'm leaving you. Can we sit down and talk about it? No. Can't talk about it? No. Could you explain to me how that happened? No. We live in a strange day, don't we? You have to go through all kind of hoops to get married. You don't have one hoop to get divorced. Not one. I went with a young man not many years ago to court for my church. So that we could have our day in court to tell the judge. Well, we didn't tell him he was going to hell, but it did pass our mind. With this no contest of divorce. Just walk in and say, I'm done. Jane and I always had an agreement that whoever left had to take kids, so that kept us together. Probably would have worked if we just had one, but we had four. And it kept us together for 58 years. Of course, that's not the only thing, but divorce never crossed. Murder, but never divorce. Divorce never crossed our mind. There's no way. I mean, I couldn't work with the kids 3 or 4 hours, let alone a whole life. How was that going to work? Let me close. Paul closes with a warning to Timothy and to us about this guarding. because there's great conflict over the guarding of the gospel. See, what they're going to attack you is not the gospel. They're going to attack your guarding the gospel. Now, please pay attention. If they can break through your lines, they can destroy the gospel. You understand that? If you're doing sentry duty, and there's only two guys on sentry duty, and there's 100 guys sleeping, if they break through the sentry, they got the 100. Listen to what he says. He says to Timothy, I want you to guard the deposit, and I want you not to engage in opposing arguments of the gospel of grace salvation. Don't want you to argue with it. Opposing arguments, leave them alone. Do not do it. Avoid it. Avoid it. Here's what you do. You give them the truth, and you leave it alone. You leave it alone. You deliver the mail and leave it alone. You leave it alone. You don't argue against their opinion. You don't argue against it. You give them, you state them the truth of the Word of God and let the Holy Spirit argue it out. It's not yours to argue. State the truth. State the truth and let the truth set them free. Your job is not to set them free. Your job is to give the truth. Truth's to set them free. That's John 8:32. State the case of the gospel and the faith apart from works. State it as a position. Deliver the mail and leave it. He calls the opposing argument false knowledge, which is a cosmos diabolica system of the deceiving lies of the devil. You can see it in operation if you're interested in Genesis, the 3rd chapter, when Satan engages Eve over the issue. It's discussed, by the way, not in your paper, but it's discussed in 2 Corinthians 11:3. Well worth your time to read. Listen, the bottom line is simple. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man can come to the Father except through me. That's the truth, whether you want to believe it or not. I just deliver the mail. I just deliver the mail. Let us pray. Listen, with every head bowed and every eye closed, if you've never believed, now listen to me, if you've never believed that Jesus died for your sins personally, was buried and raised from the dead 3rd day for your salvation, you've never believed that, I want you to do that right now. And then I want you to tell the Father, Father, I believe that your Son died for my sins, was buried and raised from the dead 3rd day to give me everlasting life. I want you to pray that prayer. I believe that your Son died for my sins, was buried and raised from the dead 3rd day to give me everlasting life. And I want to thank you for it. With every head bowed and every eyes closed, listen to me. I just feel this. If you've just prayed that prayer, I want you to look up here because I got some material for you. Okay. I knew it. Thank you. I'll see that you get some material that's really going to help you in this. It's going to really help you in that. Okay? Father, we're so thankful for those who are open to the gospel of Jesus Christ today. And even though this was a strange moment, just knew there was a person that needed to have that click in their soul that says, I believe. I believe. For the gospel is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes that Jesus died for their sins, was buried and raised from the dead to give eternal life. We thank you for that today, Father, that another soul has come to the full knowledge of understanding the gospel. And now it is our responsibility with great privilege we take to disciple them, Father, to show them and give them materials and show them what this wonderful thing has happened in their life. We thank you for that today, both here in this auditorium and off the in, and through the internet, that this message has been clearly understood today. And I pray for those on the internet, if they'll go to the internet and look for that material or write us, we'll see that we connect them off the internet with that proper material for their spiritual growth in Christ. We thank you, Father, for this day and for this lesson, for these that have come to us both by automobile and internet. We thank you for them in Jesus' name. Amen.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life.